Once again, welcome each and every one of you and wish you global greetings based on your time zones from where you have joined in, guys. Thank you very much for joining this session. So in this particular session, which is being termed as webinar, guys, we're going to be discussing about Spring Core. What exactly the Spring Core is, why exactly we require Spring Core, and why exactly I should choose Spring Core on any other framework which are available with me. My name is Sandeep Tomar, and I'll be taking you through into this particular webinar. I'll formally introduce myself to you guys. My name is Sandeep Tomar. I work as a corporate trainer with Koenig Solutions, guys. Having experience of more than 12 years in the industry, worked in production as well as training domain, okay? And some of my prestigious clients which I've worked with is Oracle, Microsoft, British Petroleum. There are many other as well, but these are the major clients with which I have worked on, guys. In my this stint of 12 years, guys, I have spent around 7 years in the production industry. When I was in the production industry, I was implementing projects on major frameworks of Java. I started working with Sturts 1.1 back in 2010. And then I moved on to many other like associated frameworks like Spring MVC, Spring Core, and other associated projects. When I moved into the training industry, guys, I started delivering training on Java. Then I have also delivered training on Microsoft-related technologies like .NET. And I'm also a certified data engineer, guys. So this is all about myself. I'll just continue through this. Then I worked for a company called Koenig Solutions, guys. I have spent around 4 years in this particular organization. And we have been the global IT training industry around the world, guys, having offices in India, USA, Canada, UK, South Africa, Dubai, Singapore. And we are still expanding, guys. Our focus is to have a training area or a training office in each and every country in the world. So we have been associated with many training firms, guys. We start with Microsoft. We have an association with Cisco, Oracle, CompTIA, VMware. We have the training all around the world, and we deliver Microsoft and Oracle training to the most of the corporates in the world. The corporates in India, if I talk about, we deliver training for Infosys, Wipro, TCS, Capgemini, all around the world, guys. So this is what exactly Koenig Solution is, and this is the organization which we all which I work for. So now let's just set the agenda for this session, guys. First of all, we would like to discuss that what exactly, or we have to explore that what exactly Spring Core is, okay? And there are many components of Spring Core, which we're going to be discussing, but our primary focus will be on these two things. Okay. These two things means IOC and TI. Okay. In IOC stands for inversion of control, and TI stands for direct injection. Okay. So over here, guys, we'll also discuss that why exactly do we require a framework to develop a web application or any other kind of application, guys? Okay. Then after that, we'll also discuss that why do we require Spring? We have frameworks, we have other frameworks in the world, guys. And then why exactly are we actually being focusing, or why exactly are we conducting this webinar, and why exactly have you joined in this webinar for Spring, guys? Okay. So let's discuss this. Now, first of all, I would like to tell you guys, why exactly do we require a framework? Okay. First of all, Spring is a framework, guys. Okay. Spring is a framework. So what exactly we have to decide, that it's not a programming language, guys. It's a structure in which we write a program. That's what the exact difference between a framework and a programming language. In my sessions, I usually get this question, and they ask me, Sandeep, is Spring a programming language? No, Spring works on Java. The syntaxes, the other things which are associated with a programming language is in or from Java itself. But why do we require a framework? Framework, guys. Framework is being required so that the repeated activities can be taken care of. Please understand this. I'm just giving you a very layman's example, guys. Okay. Framework in any of the programming language is required so that we can take care of the work which is being considered as an overhead on programmers. Now, if you will write a simple Java program, guys, if you will write a simple Java program over here, let's say, I'll just say simple Java program. Now, when you're writing this simple Java program, you are responsible for doing everything. You're responsible for writing this class. You're responsible for invoking this particular class. You're responsible for creating the object. You're responsible for everything, guys. Now, this can be easy or this can be feasible to each and every one of us when the scope or the objective of this program is very small. When we just have to add 1 plus 1, or when we just have to add 2 numbers, or when we have to do something which is very small scale, guys. But that doesn't work in the industry. In the industry, we have to design enterprise level programs, guys. We have to design enterprise solutions. And when we have to design enterprise solutions, guys, if I'll keep on doing these things, it will take a very, very, very long time, guys. It will take a very long time in the development of the project. Also, that's the first thing, that if we are using any framework in any of the programming language, definitely it will reduce my effort while writing that. Second thing, this is the first one. Second thing, guys, it provides me a structure. Now, guys, when thousands of classes are written and thousands of objects has to be created on a single click of a program, or when you are using a single functionality of any application, we definitely need to have a structure, guys. Because if the structure is not there, we will not be able to maintain that application. So in the enterprise level solution, if we are not being able to maintain our application, then definitely that won't be considered a feasible solution, guys. Nobody will spend so much of money to create a solution that can only be used once or that cannot be upgraded. No, definitely upgrades are required. And how can we create an application which is easy to upgrade, which is easy to maintain? By following a particular structure. So when we work with frameworks, we get a structure to work. Second thing. Now, what happens is, third one. Now, when you are working with an enterprise level application, guys, we need to be very sure whether we are using the resources efficiently or not. Because when you are creating or when you are executing a simple program, even if you are not closing your objects, even if you are not killing all your connections, that is okay, because we are just running a simple program that doesn't eat up a lot of resources of yours. But that doesn't work with an enterprise level application, guys. In an enterprise level application, we have to follow some standards, and those standards will actually make your application an effective one, an efficient one. Okay, so what happens is, guys, that framework provides me efficiency. So first of all, they helps me to create or to build an enterprise solution for me. Then that enterprise solution is being created based on a structure, and because of that particular structure, I'll be able to maintain that particular application. Okay, I'll be able to maintain that particular application. Then after that, even after the maintenance of the application, I am not using the resources abruptly. I'm not consuming the RAM of the server. I'm not consuming the resources of my client system inefficiently. My application is easy to use. My application is being light to use. Okay. So these are the three things which majorly helps us to decide whether we would like to go for a plain application or for a framework. So clearly, framework is a winner over here. We definitely have to go for framework because this is not even a facility. This is a necessity, guys. Okay. I'm not getting something which can be considered as luxury over here. It is being converted into the necessity in this world. Okay. So that's why we're going to be using framework then. Why I would be going for Spring, guys? Okay. First of all, Spring is a framework which is based on Java, guys. And we all know that Java is a programming language on which hundreds of systems are still running, guys. And they are still developing the systems in this particular programming language. And systems, I'm not talking about anything which is being running on very small scale. I told you in my introduction, guys, I have been worked with many, many, many clients whose complete organization is being depending on the Java language, guys. Their complete infrastructure, especially the application infrastructure, is being running on Java. So Spring becomes important because we don't have to go out of Java to implement the Spring infrastructure, guys. So we have Spring over here that supports Java. Also, it has all the associated features which are there in any other framework. So it's not like that functionality wise or support wise Spring is behind any one of the frameworks available in the world. Definitely, Spring provides you an end-to-end solution for your application, guys. Be it's front-end or back-end, you can develop an end-to-end enterprise solution using Spring framework, guys. So these are the few points which I would like to discuss with you. Definitely, in our upcoming discussions during this particular webinar, we'll see what exactly IOC is, what exactly dependency injection is. So all those features will be discussed in detail. But few things which I would like you people to know, that why are we using frameworks and why we have to go for Spring, or why am I choosing Spring as a framework for my application, is being discussed with you. Okay, so let's just go ahead and discuss about Spring modules. Now, definitely, guys. Now you know that Spring is a framework now. Okay, so framework have multiple modules. Here we are. So you can see on the screen, guys, that we have some associated modules of Spring. Okay, so we'll decide. We'll discuss it one by one. Okay, so here we are. Now, guys, these particular modules will start with DAO. Now, guys, when we talk about framework, and I told you that the major reason of selecting any framework is that I want structure. And definitely, the structure can only be available if my functionalities is being divided, into modules. Okay, so these are the modules over here. Now, before discussing this, I would like to tell you how exactly a web application works. We use web applications day in and day out, but what exactly happens in the backend? Because we need to get into these modules based on the web application. So guys, web application, first of all, we have a front end of a web application, guys. Front end. Now, what exactly a front end is? Front end is that particular part, guys, which is actually visible to the user. Now you log into an application, or you opened an application, a web application, you opened a URL on an application is there in front of you, guys. You'll be able to see the home page, you'll be able to see the login page, you'll be able to see dashboards, you'll be able to see buttons, menus, all those things. From where exactly are they getting? That is the particular section of an application, guys, which is being called as front end. This front end is something which is visible to the user, but it cannot do each and everything on its own. It won't be able to do everything on its own. You cannot put each and every functionality in the front end itself, guys. Then this front end is visible to the user and user will actually be working on this particular section of the application. This front end will actually be getting connected to the second section of any web application, and that is being called as backend. Now, what exactly this backend is? Backend section of any application is where the business logic is being written, where the core of that application is being kept. All the functionalities, all the features is being implemented over here. Your business logic is being written over here. Now, is front end and back end is capable of running a web application? No, guys. Even that's not enough. You have a front end section, you have a back end section. Even that is not enough. Now, what happens is I need to connect this back end to the database, guys. Now, this is how our application works, guys. User will always get in touch with the front end. Then after that, you have a back end. Okay. In the back end, we have written the business logic. Now, the business logic, when you are executing a business logic, definitely there will be some modification in the data. There will be generation of new data, or there will be modification of new data, or there will be removal of some data. Now, definitely to do so, the back end has to get connected to database, guys. And database connectivity will be established between backend and front end. Okay, so over here, these modules will actually be able to help you to accomplish this particular objective of yours. Now, it might happen, guys. In this modern world, what happens is there can be multiple front end, guys. Please understand this. Now, you have an application. Take an example of your bank, guys. Now, each and every one of you is being having a bank account. Now, definitely, you have an internet portal where you can log in and do the transactions on your bank account. You can check some information on your bank account. Now, the same thing can be done from a mobile app as well. Correct? Each and every one of us do that day in and day out. So, what happens, guys? There is a front end for a web application. There is a front end for a mobile application as well. So, what happens is, same front end can get connected to the different front ends can get connected to the same backend. Now, this saves a lot of coding in the backend because the transaction details which you are viewing in your mobile app and the transaction details which you are viewing in your web-based banking portal are same. They're not different. That means we are working on the same data. The only thing is how exactly am I accessing it and how exactly I'm viewing it is different. So what exactly has to be changed? Only the front end of the application has to be changed. So this is how exactly the application looks like. So these are the modules over here. Okay. So all the modules have different work to do. Here we are. DAO. In this particular DAO component, we'll write all the classes which will interact with database. Okay, so all the database connectivity, all the connections and everything will be established, and all the JDBC related work will be done in DAO classes. So we have a section, we have a module which takes care of the database connection management or the transaction management with database. Then we have ORM. Now, what exactly this module is being responsible for? Now, this module is being responsible for the transmission of data. Transmission of data means in the older section of the frameworks, guys, we have to use queries. We have to write SQL queries, and those SQL queries will get executed on the database. Now, that was a fantastic system, guys, but that particular system fails, or I should say lacks swiftness. That was not very fast. Then we came up and we advanced ourselves into object relational mapping. Now ORM means object relational mapping. Now what exactly are we doing over here? We are actually converting the database of like the we are actually converting our code into a language which can understood by database. So all the communication with the database will be done through ORM. Now we have many options over here, guys. You can make use of Hibernate. Over here, you can make use of JPA, JDO, OG, like OJB. All these are the options which is being available to you. You can use any one of them as part of ORM, guys. Okay, now over here, let's just move ahead with JEE. Now that is where the messaging parts is being taken care of. From the front end to back end, how exactly are we communicating? Okay, how exactly are we communicating? That's what we're gonna be doing as part of JEE. Then, where exactly is the business logic in terms of front end and back end is being written? This is the section. Web is the section where we'll make use of Spring Web MVC, framework integration, or you can make use of studs or JSF or JSPs, whatever. So many things are there. You can use one of them, or you can just mix one or two of them based on your requirement. Then, how exactly the object creation process is being controlled? Then, for that, we have AOP. The object process will be controlled by this section of the Spring. Okay, this particular module of the Spring. So if you'll figure out, guys, the connection to the database, the transaction management with the database, communication between front end and back end, business logic in terms of business logic and design, design in terms of front end and business logic in terms of back end can be written on web, and the complete object creation process is being taken care by different modules of Spring, guys. And that's what I was talking about. We have a structure, guys. This is what I mean, and I refer by structure, guys. This is what I mean, and I refer by structure. This is what the structure is, guys. Okay, so now over here, guys, when we have a complete structure to define, I know that if I have to make a change in my database transactions, I'll do it over here. I know if I have to make anything in terms of my queries, I have to go over here. I know if I have to make any change in the communication, I'll go over here. If in business logic and design, I'll go over here. So that's the structure and the maintainability over here. And that's how Spring works, guys. Okay. So this is what exactly we have. Here comes the inversion of control. Okay. So we'll discuss about this topic now. Now, definitely, guys, we all are programmer. We understand what exactly programming is. And as I told you guys, when we start learning programming, we'll always start with a very simple programs. I'm just telling you what exactly I faced. When I was in my college, I started writing programs, and then I myself thought that how can these small programs will be able to run the business of major stakeholders in the world, because this is very small and this becomes complicated when I create it on a large scale. So IOC, inversion of control, actually helps me to achieve that. So it provides me a concept of new programming. Okay, so what exactly are we doing over here? The programmer has the concern about usage of objects. Now guys, please understand this. I have written, let's say, three classes. Please understand this, guys. It's really important. I've written three classes over here. Okay. And these three classes are my major three class. And hundreds of users are actually using these particular classes for me. Every day, what exactly is being happening? Those 100 users are coming and they are creating objects of these classes. Definitely. Won't create an object of the class, I won't be able to use them. To use them, I need to have my own instance of them, and the instance can only be created when I have an object of it. So let's say 100 people every time coming in, 100 objects for this particular class got created, 100 objects of this particular class got created, and 100 objects of this particular class got created. Now this is being happening every day. Every day, these 100 objects are created, and I'm not taking care of them. Because when we talk about simple programming, we don't take care of what exactly is being happened to the object. I just create them, use them, and just leave it like that. I'll terminate my program, done. But we never thought of what is being happening to these objects. But guys, when we are designing an enterprise level solution, I need to thought of. Because what happens is, if I'm not taking care of these objects will become in thousands, in millions very soon. And they are consuming spaces. My server is overloaded. My network is not behaving properly because the things are not being taken care of. So for a programmer, the usage of object is always a concern. Okay. And this is what exactly IOC is being doing for me. It takes care of the object creation. Please understand this. It takes care of the object creation. It takes care of the lifecycle management of the object. It also takes care of the dependency satisfaction. All this is the responsibility on a third party called IOC container. That means I have a section. Okay, I have a section where all these things is being taken care of. Creation of the object. When the object has to be created, I just have to provide the instructions. Automatically, the object will be created. Based on my instructions, the life cycle of the object is being decided. Life cycle means how long it will be. Will it be there for like as long as the session is being running? Will it be there once the functionality is being finished, the object will be killed or the garbage collector will do its job? Dependency satisfaction means in an enterprise level application, we understand, guys, I need an object of this particular class to work with this particular class. I might have some inheritance. I might have some interface running between them. So it's not only that individual objects are created. These objects are interdependent to the classes. So that dependency satisfaction is also being taken care of. What I have to do? I just have to provide the instructions to IOC and IOC container will take care of it. Okay, so what exactly, what advantage does it brings to me? It brings to me the increase in the productivity of the programmer because I don't have to take care of every small thing in my program, guys. And at an industry level, if we have a good productivity of a programmer, we'll be able to finish our project faster, guys. We won't be able to work on the same project for years, guys. Okay, which we used to do like 20-25 years back. It was very increase object reusability. Now this object reusability is nothing but efficiency. I have an object which I can reuse. I keep on reusing it wherever it is being required without doing any extra effort, guys. I'm not doing any extra effort for that. It's the IOC who has been doing it for me. I've just provided my instructions to them and done. That's all I have to do. Then, as I told you, easy application maintenance. When the structure is not complex, maintenance are always easy, guys. And we all understand, guys, you people are all there in the industry for quite a long now. Definitely, you understand that maintenance of the application is much, much, much more important than the actual creation of the application, guys. So that's what the importance of IOC is, inversion of control. Now IOC has three responsibilities, even though we have already discussed them, but I'll quickly walk you through that. Object creation. If any object needs to be created based on the business logic I have written, the object creation will be done through IOC container. Then dependency satisfaction. Definitely the dependency satisfaction will be done through IOC only, but it will be done through a subset of IOC, that is dependency injection. Okay, then lifecycle management. How long my object will be there in the system? I have to decide that, but internally I don't have to write any business logic to do so. I just have to pass my instructions and my instructions will be implemented in the backend to achieve the lifecycle management of this particular object or any particular object. Now, dependency injection, guys, we will actually be studying it in the upcoming sessions, that dependency satisfaction can be implemented in two ways. First is dependency injection. Now that's what is being provided to you by Spring. Okay. Now, if you don't want to go with it, this is being supported by Spring. But we have a legacy process as well that is being called as dependency lookup, which is actually a legacy process. So majorly, if we are going for a Spring related application, so dependency injection is something which we're going to be using for dependency satisfaction. Dependency satisfaction, I've already told you guys what exactly a dependency satisfaction is. When the dependency on the object of any other class has to be satisfied. Class A can only function if the object of class B and class C has also been created. So who gonna be taking care of that? Dependency injection. Okay, so that's what the purpose of it. Okay, Spring container. Okay, so we have a Spring container where the things start. So Bean Factory are the simplest of the container, provides basic support for dependency injection. What exactly we create, guys? We create Bean Factory classes. These Bean Factory classes will actually be the base of the containers. These are the base of the containers from where? Okay, these are the building stones of your Spring application, guys. So first of all, you'll be writing a Bean Factory classes, which are the simplest of the container, and it provides the basic supports for dependency injection. Now, application context, which is the next particular topic over here, application context built on the notion of a Bean Factory by providing application framework services. Now, please understand this, guys. We have Bean Factories. We have a complete module. Okay, understand this, that we have a complete module over here, the IOC module, which is actually being taking care of creation of the object, which is actually being taking care of the dependency injection, it has been taking care of the life cycle. But please understand this, guys, that I have to provide them the instructions. It's not like that they know that when and where the object has to be created. No, guys, it's not robotics or it's not artificial intelligence. It's like the background work will be done by them, but I have to pass them the instructions. Okay, I have to pass them the instructions. And how exactly I'll pass the instructions? We'll pass the instructions through application context. There are multiple ways of passing the instructions over here, guys. I can pass them through an XML file. Here we are. Okay, application context. How exactly we have, like, what different flavors of application context I have? How exactly we can work with? So, in a very simple way, guys, all these are the classes. If you have seen a Spring class or if you have seen a Spring application anytime, you'll always find these things over there. Okay, you have an annotation config application context. This is the class which is responsible for it loads a Spring application context. Okay, whatever context you have provided, whatever instructions you have written, this will be providing. Now, that's not the only option we have. We have annotation config web application context. Now, if the application which you are creating is a web application, then definitely this will be the class which will be helpful for you. You have to load a Spring web application over here. So you will be using this one. Then after that, you have class path XML application context. Now, if you are actually creating some application context, then you will be using this particular class to load that. Load a context definition from one or more XML file located in the class path. You will define the structure. Okay. You will define the structure. Okay. You'll define the structure. And once the structure is being defined, that structure will be read from an XML file, guys. It can be one or more than one XML file, guys. Okay, so your what type of class you want, when exactly the object has to be created, what exactly is the life cycle of that object, you will actually be mentioning it in an XML file, and that is being kept at one particular class path. And definitely when the application get loaded, the class path, the file kept at the class path will be picked up, and based on that, all the context and all the like the object creation and other associated activities will be done based on this XML file. Now you can have multiple XML file and you can have like one as well. Okay, file system XML context file, load a context definition from more and like one or more XML file in file system. Now understand this, guys. Now you don't want to keep that XML file in the class path, guys. You don't want to keep it. You want to keep it separate. Okay, now that flexibility is being provided to you over here if you'll use this particular class. So if you are putting your XML file in the file system of the server, not in the class path of your application, guys, then definitely this is the class which is being provided to you. You just have to instantize this particular class and just start using it. Okay, then you have XML web application context. Load context definitions for one or more XML file in a web application. Now these are for the standalone application, and here we are for the web application where the web application is being running. So now please understand this, guys. These are the classes. Actually, please understand this. These are the classes which is already being written as part of the framework. You don't have to write these classes, guys. You just have to use the functionalities written inside these classes. Okay, there are functions, there are variables which are already being designed or that has already been defined, and you just have to use them as per your requirement in your application. Now options are there in front of you, guys, based on your requirement, based on your design pattern, or based on anything which is being associated with your application. You can choose any one of them, guys. Okay, so these are the flavors of application context which is being available. Now, as I told you, guys, Spring configuration. Now, configuration is very important, guys, because in that particular, as I told you, guys, that even the responsibility of doing everything is being there with. Okay, responsibility of doing most of the things lies with Spring framework. But I have to provide them instructions. And when I just have to provide them instructions, in a programming language, we call it as configuration. Okay, so Spring is actually flexible in terms of providing you the options to create your configurations as well. Okay, so what you can do, guys, you can actually create configurations, or you can actually define your configurations in three ways, guys. First is, you just have to write an XML file of your configuration. You can put it on the file system, or you can put it on a class path. Definitely, if I'll just go back over here, these are the two classes which got associated with it. If it is in the file system, then definitely we have to use this class to load it. If it is in the class path, then this file will be used. Okay, so here we are, we have XML file. Then it's not necessary that you have to write, like you have to go and write the XML file only. You can provide the configuration in Java as well. Okay, you can write simple Java classes. You can write Java classes to define your configurations. That is also available. If you think that going through XML is not a feasible option for you, which is actually not. Now, this is something which is not preferred a lot, guys, because changing configuration in XML is not very heavy on the system. But if you're changing any configuration in Java, then recompilation and rebooting of the system is being required every time. So this is not a very favorable option to use in terms of enterprise development, guys. Then we have the most famous one, and that is implicit bean discovery and automatic wiring, where I'll just define and automatically things will be mapped. So this is the most used one. These are the three options we have in terms of Spring configuration, guys. Okay, now XML configuration. Here we are, guys. Now this is an example which is being given over here. So please focus over here, guys, that what exactly we have. We have, when a bean is asked from an IOC container, means exactly I'm asking that please provide me an object of this particular class. It identifies the class by using attributes. Please understand this, that we have these attributes, ID, name, class, and these are the, I'll just define the things like that in my XML file, and Spring container will actually read all these things, and based on this configuration, it will provide me the, like it will provide me the objects required. Okay, so ID is defined. Okay, ID if defined, ID if defined is used. Okay, if ID is not defined, then name attribute is used. It's not compulsory that I have ID for everything. If I don't have the ID, then definitely the name attribute will be used. If ID and name is not defined, then the fully qualified class name is used. So it will look for ID. If ID is not defined, it will look for name. If name is not defined, then here is the exact class for which I require an object, guys. So it will create an object for this particular class, and it will provide me. So wherever or whenever I require a object of this particular class called .com.trainee, I just have to mention it in my XML configuration file. And once that configuration file got loaded or is being executed, in the start of the application, all these objects are ready to use for me. And once the application or once I'm done with my work, I don't have to worry about where exactly the object of dog, like the trainee class, has gone. No, it will be taken care of automatically, guys. So I don't have to do anything in that. Okay. So this is how exactly it works, guys. You can see over here, guys. Now, this is the resource. Please see it. This is a pictorial representation I'm showing you over here, guys. Okay. So this is what exactly is being happening. So what happens over here, guys, that we have Spring Client, that is Java app. We have resource, Bean Factory, and Bean. Okay. So what happens is that Spring Client request, the request will go to the resource section, and it will also go to the Bean Factory. Okay. So over here, guys, from the Bean Factory, while communicating, it'll confirm everything from here, and definitely a bean is being provided to you at the end. Now, what exactly all these numbers means to us, I have defined them over here. Please understand this. Using new instance, a resource is created. Once I'll use this particular functions of new instance, a resource got created. Contains info of the bean that has to be managed by IOC. This particular instance, I'll pass all the information of my beans that has to be managed by IOC. That means I'm telling them that this is the class which I want you to manage. And the information of that particular class, I will be passing as part of this particular function. Then after that, once it reaches to the IOC container, Bean Factory is created, and the reference of the resource object is being provided. Means the reference of the resource object is being provided to the Bean Factory, and the bean is asked for IOC container. That means the bean is being created and it is being ready to use. Okay, so over here, guys, once the bean is being created, it will find out the info of the bean. Means once the object, the bean is being created, guys, then internally we'll go and check whether all the dependencies associated with this bean, okay, all the things which is being associated with this bean is being done or not. Okay, then after that, once everything is being finalized, the reference is being written. So this is the whole story. This is the whole story of what exactly is being going behind the scene, guys. Okay, this is how exactly the things work internally in the bean. Okay, now I told you about automatic configuration, guys. I told you that how exactly the configuration, I don't have to go and create any XML file externally or anything. How can I do that? Okay, so what exactly we can do that? We can do that by annotations, guys. Okay, we can do that by annotations. So which all annotations we can use over here, configuration and the component scan. Okay, the component scanning is the part of the section where Spring automatically discovers beans to be created in the application context. Means I have already added an annotation before creating this training configuration class, and I've told that please implement the feature of component scan over here. The component scan over here is now automatically the Springs will find out where exactly these classes is being used and at what particular time the object of this particular class, which is being called as training configuration, is being required, and automatically it will provide the object at that particular time. So it is also reducing my overhead work a lot, but this is being depending on you guys. It's not compulsory that you always have to go for automatic configuration only. You can go with Java based configuration, you can go with XML based configuration, or you can go with automatic configurations over here. Automatic configurations is being derived through annotations. Okay, I hope that each and every one of you is being aware about annotations, guys. Okay, so everything is being provided with this annotations. So this is how exactly it looks like, guys. Okay, this is how exactly it look like. So Java config, we have this class. I have just added the configuration, like I have added an annotation over here. I have also added the auto, the component scan annotation over here. And inside this, I have already every time when this will be executed, okay, every time when this will be executed, I will get a prepared bean written from this particular function, guys. Okay, when the bean of this particular class will be created, definitely I will also return a bean of trainee class. Okay, I'll also return a bean of trainee class, guys. Okay, so this is something, guys, which is there, this is something which is being there with us, guys, in terms of Java configuration. Due to the limitation of the time, guys, the things cannot be, like, over here cannot be discussed in a very detailed way, but definitely, guys, like, Spring itself is a very, very, very large topic to explore. The components associated with the the Spring is itself a very, very, very big topic to discuss with. Okay, this was just an attempt to make you aware of how exactly the Java and the associated Spring framework works with Java, guys. Okay, what is the benefits of using it? Okay, so I hope that you find it interesting, and definitely I have just planted a small seed in your head, which actually grows up with the more knowledge you want to acquire about this particular topic, guys. In the in our actual trainings, guys, we have a lot of labs to be accomplished. We have the demonstrations as well, which demonstrations also are there, which will be performed in front of you. So it's not like that everything will be it's not like that we have the theoretical topics to be discussed, but implementations of these topics are also there, guys. But all those things definitely require some time to be accomplished, guys. So that's what we have as part of our today's webinar. And I thank you very much for your time, guys. Thanks a lot. So I just have to stop sharing my screen now. Thank you, guys. Thanks a lot. I can see that there are a few questions on the chat window. Definitely, Ram sir, can you just help the participant over here? There are a few questions which I think you should address. We keep on just to add up over here, guys, we keep on conducting these kind of sessions. And this is just to motivate you you people just get encouraged. And we have a full time sessions for this. Actually, the training, which is the training is actually of 4 days. Okay, so a 4-day complete training is being there. We have many instructors which are very good in delivering these kind of sessions. I myself deliver sessions. So you can always get in touch with, you can always visit our website. You can always come and see when those batches is being scheduled. So if any batches suits your time, you can always come in and we'll definitely be, we'll be more than happy to help you in that context, guys. And we also have multiple delivery patterns, guys. We have the ILO pattern is being there, which is being delivered online like this webinar. We also have the ILT one where you have to visit a classroom and our trainer will also visit the classroom. In the online classes, guys, we have multiple formats of the batches. Like you can take it in a 4-hour session every day. You can take it and you can take 8 hours training as well. So the flexibility is being there. So I suggest all of you to please visit our website, come see all the courses and give us an opportunity to serve you. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Thank you very much, guys. It's been a pleasure delivering this session for you people. Thanks a lot.